I'm delighted to welcome existing colleagues and friends of the college, and also those who are discovering us for the first time. My name is Bill Foster, and I am the vice principal of Homerton College. I welcome you on behalf of the principal, Jeffrey Ward, who is sadly stricken with the flu. He will be sad to miss this splendid occasion, but will have the compensation of the video recording. On his and the college's behalf, then, I offer a threefold welcome. Welcome to Homerton, a college both old and new. Old because we were founded in London in 1768. Now, as a historian, I should mention that this particular founding date could possibly set off a lively debate. But in any event, old as well because the core of the college buildings here are 19th century, as you will see if you join us later after the lecture for drinks in the Great Hall, as I hope you will. We are new because it was in 2010 that Homerton became a full Cambridge college, offering almost all subjects. That diversification is complete this year with our first medical students. New, too, because the college is in a growth phase. We will have a new Porter's Lodge in the next few years. We already have well-developed plans for a grand dining hall to complement the Victorian Great Hall. And we are in the process of renovating the building just outside to include an expanded gym and a new archive center. The buildings, though, are a mere stage set for our people to excel. And excel they do. This year, our undergraduates posted the college's best academic results ever, with over 90% achieving a first or 2-1. Welcome, secondly, to the Kate Pretty Lecture. Kate served the college as principal for 22 years, over a period of tremendous change for the college, change which Kate led and shaped, and which culminated in 2010 with the award of the Royal Charter as a full Cambridge College. For six of those years, she served concurrently as Pro-Vice-Chancellor of the university, responsible for international strategy, outreach, lifelong learning, and museums and libraries. A distinguished archaeologist, Dr. Pretty served as president of the Council for British Archaeology from 2008 to 2013. And I would like to add that Kate was and is a mentor and tireless champion of the careers of her junior colleagues in the Homerton Fellowship and in the wider university. Kate, we are tremendously proud to launch this annual lecture in your name and delighted to see you back. And so to the final element of my threefold welcome, a welcome to the Vice Chancellor, Professor Sir Leszek Borysiewicz. Sir Leszek was appointed as the 345th Vice Chancellor of the University of Cambridge on 1 October 2010. He is a founding fellow of the Academy of Medical Sciences, a fellow of the Royal Society, and an honorary fellow of Wolfson College. Before coming to Cambridge, Sir Leszek was previously chief executive of the UK's Medical Research Council, principal of the Faculty of Medicine and deputy rector at Imperial College London, and a lecturer and professor of medicine at the University of Wales. He was knighted in 2001 for services to medical research and education. His work in vaccines included Europe's first trial of a vaccine for human papillomavirus to prevent cervical cancer. We are fortunate indeed to have Sir Leszek give this inaugural lecture. He steps down as Vice Chancellor at the end of his tenure on 30 September this year. In his time in Cambridge, he has enhanced the University of Cambridge's standing, both regionally and internationally. The Northwest Cambridge and biomedical campus developments are two concrete physical examples of his local impact. Internationally, he has strengthened the university's profile by increased engagement and the building of strategic partnerships in India, Africa, and across Europe. He has argued passionately in favor of an open and international world of academic excellence, both as a participant in that world himself and as a child of refugees for whom the free movement of minds carries an intense and personal meaning. With the greatest pleasure, I invite the Vice Chancellor to deliver the first Kate Pretty Lecture, The Cambridge of Tomorrow.
Well, firstly, Bill, thank you very much indeed for that very kind introduction. It's rather strange sitting here to actually be already thinking that 7 years are nearly up. But it is a particular privilege for me to be invited to address you for this inaugural Kate Pretty Lecture. As you well know all too well from recent events, an inaugural address can set the tone of things to come. So I must be very careful in what I say today. Promise no alternative facts, or should I say no alternative facts. I am very pleased to join you as it prepares to mark the 250th anniversary of the foundation of Homerton this year. And it's an incredible opportunity to reflect how far the college has come. From, as you said, Bill, its establishment as the Homerton Academy in East London, to its move to Cambridge in the 19th century, to gaining its status as the 31st college of the University of Cambridge in 2010. And Homerton's accession to full membership was navigated by Sir David Harrison, chair of the college's trustees, and of course, by the person in whose honor we're gathered here and in whose name the college has created this new annual lecture. So today it is right that we celebrate Kate Pretty's contribution to collegiate Cambridge, her capacity for leadership, and her record as a builder of institutions. And Professor Ward, her successor as principal, I know is energetically building on these foundations. And frankly, Homerton's future as a successful and ambitious Cambridge College is assured. So there is my first prediction of the Cambridge of tomorrow. Indeed, this is an excellent place where to speak of the Cambridge of tomorrow. And I'm both grateful for and actually daunted by the invitation to address this topic. I'm particularly grateful because these days people tend to ask me to reflect on the past few years as Vice Chancellor. So the opportunity to look ahead rather than behind is really daunting and yet one which is exciting. I have to beware though, because I do have to worry about that expression by one economics forecaster who famously put it, "He who lives by the crystal ball soon learns to eat broken glass." And who would be bold enough or foolish to say in these unsettled times what the future actually holds in store for us? Perhaps the argument can be made that all of us, and certainly all of us in positions of leadership, should be gazing intently into that crystal ball. It is far too easy to get caught up in the whirlwind of current events. It's far too easy to allow ourselves to be overwhelmed by the immediate and lose sight of what is fundamental and long-term. So it's worth stepping out of the whirlwind for a moment and reminding ourselves of what we are here for. And one advantage of heading an organization that has been around for over 800 years is that it forces us to take a longer view of things. Kate, being an archaeologist, I'm sure you'd really agree with that statement. And so tonight, I'd like to share some thoughts on what the Cambridge of tomorrow looks like, or at least what I hope it will look like from where I'm standing. Well, let's begin and begin, first of all, by maybe pondering on what Cambridge looks like today. And to tackle this, I look back over my inaugural address as Vice-Chancellor to see what I thought could be achieved over this period of time. And at that time, I singled out certain activities that makes Cambridge distinct. The first of these was the collegiate nature of the university as one of our greatest strengths. 7 years later, the university and the 31 colleges work more closely together than at any other time that I've certainly experienced or have had the opportunity to know. And that's a fantastic achievement by all the heads of house. And yes, there are always going to be differences with people with strong views, but nevertheless, that capacity to work together is fundamental for the future. There are things that can only be handled properly when we do them in concert. And this has allowed us to, for example, establish common practices to manage in a consistent and joined up ways matters requiring the full collegiate university. We've seen some real benefits of this following the launch of probably the most ambitious fundraising campaign in the university's history. And we're also working together to widen participation. We work together to implement safeguarding and welfare policies. We work together to ensure better provision for our burgeoning postdoctoral community. And we work together to deal with difficult issues such as sexual harassment. And we're bound by history and by a joint responsibility for our students and our staff. And frankly, we're better off doing this together. The tragedy for other universities, and believe me, I did write papers on why some universities could not become collegiate, is that it would be astronomically too expensive to establish a true collegiate structure today. So we need to be very grateful for what we have inherited in this regard. Now, another thing I spoke about in my inaugural address was the need not only to maintain or even improve the quality of our educational offer, but to widen its availability to talented applicants, whatever their background. Attracting students based on their abilities rather than their social or educational background is one of the ways in which we fulfill our mission. And here I'm really gratified by some of the results. The proportion of state sector educated students admitted to the university has increased now to nearly 63% of our admission, undergraduate admissions policy. You might say, where's that number come from? Why do we agree to an upper target of 64%? And the answer is because working with the colleges, we can identify that based on academic attainment, that's about the right ratio. We should be not based on how many attend which type of school, but who can actually attain the very high standards we rightly demand. Our undergraduate student body is more diverse. 20% of acceptances to Cambridge in the 2015 admissions round came from the black and ethnic minority background students, the highest it has ever been. But there's no room for complacency. And we need to continue to inspire young students from minority groups if they have the ability to see Cambridge as a natural destination. Because we continue to face obstacles to widening participation linked to deep-rooted and persistent educational and socioeconomic challenges across the UK, we have to work even harder. And we responded to those difficulties by enhancing our engagement with schools in areas of low participation, driven through the colleges. There's much work to still be done, and the success of the Cambridge of tomorrow will depend on this work being carried out consistently and effectively. I noted then, and I certainly note now, and I'm very proud of it, that Cambridge is on a firm financial footing. Now, it's worth just pondering the sheer financial scale of our university, and even more so of the collegiate university. The annual turnover of Cambridge University, I don't know how many of you are really aware of what those numbers are, is 1.6 billion sterling per annum. That's a huge enterprise, just short of the FT 100 companies. in terms of turnover. And our endowment, together with the colleges, is the largest in Europe at over $6 billion. And the last financial year was the most successful year for fundraising ever. The campaign, Dear World, Yours Cambridge, raised 210 million, of which the colleges contributed 130 million in 1 year. That now means that that campaign stands, and the last number I have is of about 2 weeks ago, so it's probably higher than that now, at 810 million pounds raised. But why do we need this financial security? Because, of course, we don't seek financial success for its own good, because we're not a business in the formal sense, nor do we seek primarily to make a profit. Our real profit is our ability to deliver to our students, undergraduates and postgraduates, and our staff the best possible facilities and opportunities to develop such that they can help us fulfill the mission of the university. And to remind you, that is to serve society through teaching, learning, and research at the highest international standards of excellence. And financial stability offers the freedom and ultimately the autonomy that in turn allows us to do more of what we do best and allows us to defend the underlying values of academic freedom espoused by the collegiate university. Yeah, we continue to do excellent research. Look at some of the science stories making the headlines today. Whether the electrical properties of graphene or the discovery of humans' oldest known ancestor, or how we can be inoculated against fake news. And you can be sure that Cambridge Science has been involved. That is, of course, inoculating, not creating the news or alternative facts. And because our reputation is built on that excellent research, we continue to invest in postdoctoral talent. And that's the engine house of our research output. Now, there's one final issue I reflected on in that inaugural address, and that's Cambridge's role as a global university. I spoke then of how a continued focus on external relations is necessary to maintain our leading role. You have only to consider the growth of our capacity-building initiatives in Africa, of our carbon reduction research in Singapore, our collaborations in crop science with India, or the forthcoming launch of a joint Max Planck Centre here in Cambridge, to see that the university is today more active in the world than ever. And again, I have to pay tribute to Kate, who was, as the university's first Pro-Vice-Chancellor for International Strategy, recognised that in order to be truly engaged with the world, it is not enough to let our academics establish individual links to partners overseas, but to ensure that the whole collegiate university is behind this endeavour. And in doing so, Kate laid the foundation for much of the valuable internationalisation work the university has carried out during my tenure. So this, in the broadest of strokes, is where I think the University of Cambridge stands at the moment. But I hear you say we've come here on this February evening to listen to the lecture about the Cambridge of tomorrow. Well, you can probably guess I'm stalling a little bit. If pressed, one way for me to approach the subject might be to unpick two of the challenges that we're likely to face in the years ahead. Beginning with the issue that is in the forefront of many people's minds today. Unless there is a big surprise or Tony Blair has his way, although these days anything can happen, in less than 3 weeks, we will see the beginning of the formal process to exit the European Union. The implications for the university's ability to establish partnerships overseas and to recruit the best staff and students will be considerable. Exactly how considerable, it will be difficult to say with any certainty until the process is complete. I could give you the numbers. It's relatively straightforward. If you take all staff in the university, 20% of our staff are EU nationals in this institution who've chosen to make their livelihoods here in the university, but also to bring their families to this institution. Our undergraduate student body is about 8% of EU nationals, and our new grant research income is 18% of all of our new research income is coming from the EU. These are considerable numbers. It's difficult to say what the future will hold, but I am heartened by the fact that in its white paper, the government has mentioned as one of its priorities, ensuring that the UK remains one of the best places in the world for science and innovation. I'm also reassured by the government's recognition of the importance of the UK's extensive collaborations with EU states. In fact, for me, from that white paper, it was the only glimmer of hope I could actually define. And from my own conversation with government ministers, it is obvious that they understand the value of our university to the UK's knowledge base, its value to economic growth, and its outstanding performance as a global leader and top of the top European university. The problem is that the fate of our settlement with the EU in terms of science and research will not, in the final instance, depend on Whitehall or our own government, but on the collective interests of the other 27 EU members. So I'm drawn to the conclusion that Brexit will now happen. Whatever the Cambridge of tomorrow looks like, it will have to adapt to this post-Brexit landscape. Our student intake, our ability to recruit and retain researchers, our capacity to access research funds, all will have to be, and are in fact being, as you might anticipate, recalculated, recalibrated, and rebalanced. To the university, this decision was a blow. But let's be clear, Cambridge has been through a much worse. The university has been around now for 808 years. It's survived a reformation, a counter-reformation, a reformation again, a civil war, two world wars, and many a crisis. And so we have to be confident that the university has the resilience to face this particular obstacle. Now, on the subject of obstacles, we can learn much from Kate herself, because I have been looking back at some of her speeches and her approach to problem solving at the University of Cambridge. She once remarked, "My usual strategy is to approach obstacles like water going around rocks rather than forging straight ahead." This is really good advice, and it teaches us that in the pursuit of the larger goals, particularly our values, is the ability to adapt serves us better than the determination to remain set in our ways. And I'm confident that Cambridge has that capacity to adapt and thrive in the post-Brexit scenario. But we cannot afford to be complacent. It would be foolhardy in extreme not to learn lessons from that referendum result itself. We know the City of Cambridge voted by an overwhelming majority for the UK to remain in the EU, 74%, with one of its wards, Market, in particular, returning 87.8% of its votes, the largest in the UK, in favour of staying in the EU. Where we're sitting here now, we're in the constituency of South Cambridgeshire, and that voted to remain by 60%. That was not true of neighbouring constituencies. The opposite was true. Of the five areas in the UK with the highest proportion of votes to leave, three are in the east of England, and one is Cambridgeshire itself, just 20 miles up the road to the north of us. We often make the case that what is good for the University of Cambridge, one of the area's biggest employers, probably the third largest employer in this area, will also be good for the region. I firmly believe that to be true, but one thing we learned from the referendum, that isn't the overall view of the general public in this region. A majority of people in the east of England, the values the university espouses are not the values they found meaningful or relevant to them. Now, this is worrying. It's worrying because I take the view that there is an unwritten contract between society and higher education institutions. Universities like ours are given license to operate and the space to educate and generate knowledge because what we do is for the benefit of society. The public trust placed in us is directly linked to an understanding that what we do through education, learning, and research is good for everyone. And one of the biggest risks to our legitimacy for the future and our reputation, ultimately, is the public feeling that universities' goals and our society's goals are no longer shared, or in other words, a breakdown of trust. Now, we take enormous pride in our contributions to advancement, whether it's from Darwin to the discovery of DNA, the invention of the jet engine, or an analysis of Jane Austen. These are things we take enormous pride about. Do the citizens of our region? When people in King's Lynn or Chatteris ask themselves that classic question, what has the University of Cambridge ever done for us? The answer they come up with, I'm afraid, is not that much. It was particularly galling to listen to a recent piece of reporting on the BBC contrasting Remainers in Cambridge with hardline Brexiteers elsewhere in Cambridgeshire and portraying them as two tribes at war with each other. Do you know, if we follow that scenario and we buy into that narrative, that is a recipe ultimately for disaster. So from where I stand, I completely and utterly refuse to buy into that narrative. But I do recognize the problem, and it's a very important problem for the future. If society at large does not believe that we have its interests at heart, then the failure is our own, because serving the interests of society is actually the only purpose in our mission statement. And if society at large does not believe that what we do is ultimately for the common good, we need to do a better job at engaging with it, communicating the impact of our work, and listening to them as well. It has to be a dialogue. If society at large cannot see that the research we carry out helps to save lives and improve livelihoods from East Anglia to East Africa, then it is on us to make sure that it knows. We cannot take for granted that they will wish to know. So how do we mitigate the risk of losing the public's trust? Well, I believe we do it by reaffirming and demonstrating that society's aspirations are also our own. We regain public trust by being open about what we do, about why we do it, and how we do it. And we regain public trust by widening access and enhancing levels of participation so that all families in this region and elsewhere can recognize the importance of the contribution we seek to make. Now, in fact, we're already doing this with other local universities through an outreach network which aims to double by 2020 the proportion of young people from disadvantaged backgrounds who enter higher education. We regain public trust by demonstrating how we contribute to local, regional, and national development. And here, too, we're working with all of the universities in this region and the businesses here to identify skill gaps and infrastructure needs that can make lives better. So for me, the real challenge of Brexit in years to come might not be how to adapt to a world in which our ties with Europe are diminished, because those ties are deep and will remain strong, even if we lose some of the mechanisms to help nurture them. No, I'm afraid the biggest challenge maybe how to ensure that Cambridge is more widely acknowledged as an institution firmly rooted in our region and actively seeking to benefit communities beyond our very own. That brings me to the next issue, one that in my view I think poses an even greater existential risk to universities. It is connected to the point I made earlier about public trust in our university. I was at the World Economic Forum in Davos recently, and while I was there, the communications company Edelman published the results of its annual trust barometer, and it revealed the largest ever drop in public trust in institutions of government, business, media, and NGOs. Trust in conventional institutions, the survey tells us, is at its lowest. 53% of respondents across the world believed the system had failed them. 59% of them claimed to have more trust in search engines than in human content editors when seeking information. The survey further told us that people are now as likely to believe a person like themselves as they are to believe an academic expert. Now, it may come as no surprise that the trust gap between the informed and uninformed public is growing, or that the gap is at its widest in the US, but the US, as always, is followed closely by the UK. What does it tell us that by one estimation, 52% of statements made by Donald Trump's presidential campaign were revealed on close inspection to be false, and still he won? What does it tell us that the top 20 fake stories doing the rounds during the US campaign outperformed the top 20 top real stories? Almost half of all respondents in the trust barometer believe, frankly, that facts do not matter. Now, a particular worry for many of us ahead of the UK's June referendum was the rhetoric surrounding evidence-based arguments, infamously summarized in the phrase, "People in this country have had enough of experts." But what's an expert? The dictionary definition, simple. It is the Oxford Dictionary. A person who is very knowledgeable about or skillful in a particular area. What a bizarre world this has come, that this word is now a term of abuse rather than a term of respect. The distrust of knowledge and the people who produce it has a long history in this country. In fact, we can probably trace it back, I believe, to the 18th century, and I would particularly quote the writings of Edmund Burke, who praised the English character as being rooted in common sense and empiricism. Writing on the history of anti-intellectualism in the United States, American historian Richard Hofstadter claimed that it was part of our English cultural inheritance. And in this country, Leonard Woolf observed, no people have ever despised or distrusted the intellect and intellectuals more than the British. Perhaps our former Secretary of State for Education was not being as original as he thought he was. In fact, a poll carried out by Ipsos Mori just before the referendum suggested that academics were ranked third in trustworthiness as a source of information on EU issues. But who were we behind? Friends and family and small business owners. The same poll, incidentally, showed the politicians, journalists bumping against the bottom of the trustworthiness scale. But even the perception that a university like ours cannot be trusted to generate knowledge that is pertinent to most people's lives can be profoundly damaging. It is damaging to our reputation as an institution capable of affecting social change. It is damaging to our reputation as an institution interested in improving lives, not just at our own doorstep, but wherever in the world that improvement is needed. And it is damaging to our reputation as an institution that should take a position of leadership on the most important issues of the day. So we have to ask ourselves, what is the role of a university that prides itself on educating and recruiting experts? What is our role as purveyors of expertise at a time when that very expertise is being dismissed as irrelevant? So this may be the right moment to be reminded of the university's Latin motto. I didn't know it before coming here, but of course it says, from this place, enlightenment and precious knowledge. Common sense is fine, but common sense alone does not help us cure cancer or eradicate infectious disease. Neither does common sense alone help us fight crop failure or mitigate climate change. Common sense in isolation does not help us make cities smarter, more efficient, or combat extremist ideologies, or interpret ancient civilizations and texts. Funnily, we need the experts to do that. And our university has many of them. And although I'm sure that they would agree, there is a portion of common sense that goes into the ideas which underpin their expertise. So are we going through a passing phase, or is this a real trend where your friend on Twitter or your like on Facebook is a better judge of what is factual or alternative factual? We're on the brink of a new technological leap that many people are calling the fourth industrial revolution. Our understanding of the issues that will underpin this transformation, from artificial intelligence to cybersecurity, online privacy, or the interface between the cyber and physical worlds, has been pioneered and championed at Cambridge. So let's be self-confident for a minute about our mission. Let us continue to achieve excellence in research and education, and alongside it, let's achieve excellence in outreach and communication. Let's continue to innovate and to challenge conventional wisdom. And while we do that, let's strive to be more transparent, open, and diverse. And let's continue to push the boundaries of knowledge and work hard to demonstrate the many ways in which this knowledge touches lives everywhere. Frankly, let's reclaim that mantle of expertise and make no apologies about it, as long as we can show that we have society's interest at our heart. I believe we will have the legitimacy and the autonomy to keep on doing what we do best. But this is a very big challenge over the next few years. So to reflect on the Cambridge of tomorrow is for me more than an abstract exercise. I think it's about 7 months before I step down as Vice Chancellor of the university. Cambridge will still be the place that my wife Gwen and I will call home. 7 years at the helm of this university might make some people want to run as far as possible, but I'm afraid not us. I'm deeply and very personally interested in what happens to the city, to its people, and to the wider region alongside this fantastic institution. The recent report on the Centre for Cities offers some encouraging information. It tells us that Cambridge is the most innovative city in the UK. That's measured by 341 patent applications per 100,000 of the population, a metric I was not aware of before preparing for this speech. That's actually three times more than the next place. Where do you think that might be? No, you're wrong, it's Coventry. It also tells us that Cambridge remains the UK city with the most highly qualified workforce. It also has one of the highest levels of employment. So it's a measure of Cambridge's success as a local hub that our unemployment rate is the second lowest in the country, while we also have one of the fastest growing populations in the country, up almost 2% on last year's figures. We're the third fastest growing city in terms of housing stock. The flip side is that despite real wages having gone up 3.2% in the last year and record levels of local housing of affordability for our staff remains the third worst among UK cities. Some would argue the real price of success and growth. Worryingly, Cambridge is the least equal city in the UK in terms of income distribution, followed by Oxford and London. And we have plans for 14,000 new homes in this city by 2031 and an estimated population spike of 25% over the next 20 years in Cambridgeshire. The one thing we can be sure of is that the Cambridge of tomorrow will be more densely populated, its roads will be more congested, its infrastructure under greater pressure than ever before. Some might not like that agenda, but if we are to sustain the benefits that this university in demand, we as a university have to buy into that growth model. Localism and the devolution agenda offer interesting opportunities. Now, there'll soon be an elected mayor for Cambridgeshire and Peterborough, and this may lead to more of the decisions that affect the region being made locally. For the university, all of this is really essential, but it will mean having to operate in and engaging with a much wider regional ecosystem than it has done up until now. It will also be a region in competition with others for resources and talent. So how do we pool local resources and expertise, that word again, to ensure that the East of England becomes a powerhouse for research, innovation and business rather than a London backwater? The Cambridge of tomorrow has to step up. And that means, again, engagement with that regional debate. So what will success look like for the university when an audience like this one gathers in this place for the 20th edition of the Kate Pretty Lecture, or the 30th, or the 50th? Well, first and foremost, I predict that the university will still be true to its values, established so long ago, following the collegiate model that has stood the test of time. Indeed, I still believe passionately that this university is confident in itself, is resilient, whatever the external pressures that it may encounter. I think it will have grown. It will have grown along the city's northwest-southeast axis. There'll be a bustling biomedical campus and a busy northwest Cambridge fully integrated into the university's central sites. I'm pretty confident that the university will be able to sustain the recruitment of top students and staff from around the world. But there are some worrying trends: accommodation costs, transport systems. They're not actually the academic challenges, they're the challenges of physically living in a growing city and an expensive environment. I see a university that balances its tried and tested teaching methods with growing students' demand for new approaches to learning. Now, they go on about flipped classrooms, MOOCs, we've seen them come, we've seen them go. But be certain of one thing: the technologies will continue to improve, and if we are to sustain our enviable position, we have to adapt and use them within the well-established models of the collegiate system. Paradoxically, I'm a passionate believer that those technologies will see their fruition in the one-to-one small group approaches that we actually take in this university. I also see a university that can pioneer new areas of study, and already we have this unique ability for interdisciplinarity or multidisciplinarity. That is something that we will need to nurture and cherish as we go along. It's something to be built on from the close proximity, whether it's at the college or within the university. And our ability to continue to recruit means that in this city, whether you are walking, doing the Saturday shopping, or whether you are embedded in formal meetings, you are likely to meet half a dozen of the world's expert on any field that you care to choose. A university supporting the region, because I believe we have to contribute to and identify and tackle skills shortages and to contribute to the local travel and transport needs. Goodness knows we contribute today. I'm willing to bet that 80% of the traffic jams in Cambridge are actually caused by the university at the moment. And a university in partnership with local schools and other local providers of higher education, and fully engaged with the businesses that have been developing, many of them started because of advances made in the university. Do not fight or seek to fight the expansion of the commercial side of Cambridge. There are over 4,000 companies in the Cambridge cluster. It's what captures the attention of politicians. It's what makes this region really important to the UK economy. And we need to build on that. I believe it will continue to be the heart of growth of this whole region, and it will remain the cornerstone of the Cambridge cluster. Now, that is not a given. That is something we have to strive for. We have to have that ability to translate work that goes on in the university into the real world that people live in. What else? And now I'm getting into difficult territory. A Cambridge University more flexible in its processes, maybe faster in its decision-making capacity, so that it can rise to new challenges quickly. I'm more confident of the ones I've said before than the ones I've just espoused. But let's understand one thing. Decision-making in the world today is accelerating in every phase. If we do not become more adroit, then we are in trouble. Why? If you look at the global top 15 universities, we are probably the smallest. There's one exception. Princeton is probably smaller than us, but has a huge endowment that it can more or less do what it likes. We have to adapt because we have to take a little more risk if we are to continue as an institution at the very top of that tree. That's the price of being smaller, is that you have to be more adroit, you have to be prepared to take risks with more innovation and ideas. And if you encumber yourselves with some of the structures we have today, then there are some difficulties. And I'm willing to bet every Vice Chancellor who's ever had to deliver this type of speech would have said the same for the last 150 years. But I also see a university that will be more diverse, and I hope uncompromising, in its commitment to widening participation. In 50 years' time, let's hope sooner, but it may be difficult to achieve sooner, a 50-50 ratio of male to female professors? That'd be something to aspire for. Perhaps even more women, given the current male performance of secondary school. A university with greater gender balance across all subjects, whether it's computer science to veterinary medicine to mathematics to English. A university with greater representation of all minority ethnic groups, and that is going to be essential. And a university with a wider geographic spread, not through any form of social engineering, but because it seeks to encourage more of these students to apply and is better at identifying their ability and potential. And again, technology will play a part in those means of identification. A university reaching out to its region so that when people in King's Lynn or Chatteris ask, what has the university done for us? I think it will be like that episode in the life of Brian. Well, it gave us the roads, didn't I? They gave us the houses, didn't they? Oh, and what about the sewage? Oh, and the baths and everything else. That's what I'd like to hear in 50 years' time, people in King's Lynn referring to the university, because it gives us the bedrock on which we can continue to advance. Probably our measure of whether we're successful or not is that those people never need to ask that question again. A university that understands that it mustn't make a choice between engaging locally and engaging globally, because it has to do both, and both are so embedded in its DNA, there is only one way forward, and that is to embrace the global perspective that we strive for. And a university that values its uniqueness and traditions, but does not take for granted that its uniqueness and traditions will in themselves make it a top university in what will become an ever more competitive environment. And it has to be a university that excels at creating, curating, and communicating knowledge. A university that leads the UK and is confident in its place among the pantheon of global universities, leading the way for a better future world. We are unusual, in fact, that as an autonomous and self-governing body of scholars, this future that I'm trying to portray to you is unusually in our own hands for us to be successful going forward. So no pressure on us then whatsoever. But it will demand much of my excellent successor and of those that will come after him. It will require the combined efforts of colleagues and friends I have had the pleasure of working with over the past 7 years and of the generations that will follow. And every one of us in this room today has their part to play. So let's go back to our motto, from this place, enlightenment and precious knowledge. From this place, enlightenment and precious knowledge. My most heartfelt aspiration for the Cambridge of tomorrow is that this collection of scholars, students and staff huddled together in this damp corner of East Anglia shall continue to shed light on the world. Thank you.
Thank you, Vice Chancellor, for that superb and very timely address. I think in speaking of the Cambridge of tomorrow, you've helped reveal to us our most urgent current challenges. With that in mind, I'd like to open the floor in case anyone has any questions for the Vice Chancellor. I'll have time, a few minutes, for a question and answer, if that's all right with you. And just to start things off, I might exercise Chair's prerogative and ask your opinion about what an individual college can do in the Cambridge that you see in the future, especially with the challenges that dishearten us every morning when we see the news. How can we stay more global and open in a world that is closing its borders? How do we tell our story in a world that's questioning what we do every day? What can Homerton do? What would be the Homerton of tomorrow?
Okay, what do I look for from the colleges in the sort of collegiate university spectrum? Every single college in this university provides a home. This is a very complex institution. I know that. I have about 146 direct reports. It basically is impossible to handle. What the colleges do is for every participant in a college is to break this community of scholars into bite-sized chunks. That you know who your neighbours are, you know who lives down at the corridor, you actually know who you might be meeting at lunch or dinner. Secondly, the colleges create, for me, what every other university desperately strives to do, and that's to create the point of contact. I mean, let's be honest, if all I can talk about is theoretical physics, I'm going to have a very boring dinner when I'm sitting next to an Anglo-Saxon scholar or somebody who is studying Shakespeare's Hamlet. It is just not going to happen. So it creates this bonding, and for me, the last bastion that the colleges possess of that link between the sciences, the arts, and humanities. If we lose that linkage in the colleges or the universities, where else are we going to see that bridge between the arts and humanities? The chance that we actually talk, as C.P. Snow refers to, not by the title of his book, of two societies, that he explains that we are one, but we have to be bound by a common language, and the colleges provide that. And the colleges provide sometimes a necessary contrariness within these structures and debates, where they may take a different perspective, but it's a perspective that is respected because it is taken by academics thinking a problem through carefully, so that within the collegiate university, they are absolutely unique. They're places of education, they're places of enjoyment, genuine enjoyment by those who participate in the collegiate system and contribute in their academic sense to the whole activity of the university. So for me, they are indispensable. And I did not come from a collegiate system, but now I would die defending it.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Do you think perhaps a distrust in experts has come from the fact that some of the experts make pronouncements on things that are not their subject?
Very frequently. I've probably just done so tonight as well. This is a real problem. We have to be careful, and experts have to be careful to do something that we don't like to think about. I come from a set of disciplines where we begin to talk about risk and probability in number terms. Now, we don't ever get that. All a politician is worth interested in saying is, this will never happen again. Rubbish. Everybody who's even studied the rudiments of risk will know it will happen again. It's just a question of when. So we have to be humble enough to say, this is an opinion, this is a view, this is a perspective. The trouble is, if I could turn it around the other way, the media wants certainty. They will report the person who makes the outrageous comment because that is more exciting than what is happening. And that's what we must fight against, because then we will lose the trust of what is going on. When I see in my field the capacity of a film to be produced and multi-million dollars to laud somebody who has been struck off the General Medical Council for completely incoherent experiments that prevent children getting measles, mumps and rubella vaccines on the basis of totally fictitious data, this is really something that makes me rail against this. And yet that makes a better story for some of our media than the fact that actually this is a very safe and effective procedure and stops your children getting significant illness. And so I believe there's a responsibility for us. Why did we not counter that? I'm sorry, I was right in the heart of this. We did not counter it effectively because we did not bring society with us to understand people's anxieties. We just thought a pronouncement by the experts would be enough. We did not engage in the debate. So for me, experts have to have a degree of humility as to what they say, and secondly, they have to be prepared to engage in the debate. And I would be asking the media, please enable this to be a real debate and not just a series of pronouncements, which is what we get from so many positions of authority at the moment. So that's what it is.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Anthony Karp, and I'm a local community reporter, and this is my childhood neighbourhood, and I'm also doing local history as well. This used to be my 100 metres athletics track when I was at primary school, and I played in several music concerts in the big auditorium here at primary school, and we also used to be able to pick apples in the apple orchard when we were younger. We can't do that now, because unfortunately there are lots of private keep out signs. So my first challenge to Homerton College is, please can you take down those private keep out signs and welcome the local community back into the college like you used to do when I was about so big? Question for you, Vice-Chancellor. I've been reading a lot about the wonderful Florence Ada Keynes, who was a figure who did so much for Cambridge University and so much for our city. She was, I think, the second or third woman mayor and the first elected woman councillor in our city. And learning from her example, I was wondering how you saw Cambridge University and we, the townfolk of Cambridge, working together. I'm thinking in particular of a book Brian Little wrote, where he called for a new concert hall funded both by the town and the gown, and also about the archives, Cambridge University's UL archives and the county's archives coming together, for example, let's say for a digitization program, given the amount of money you said the university has raised. Thank you.
I would actually say the county and the region working together, university. So first and foremost, does the university create that engagement? Fitzwilliam Museum, most people don't know it, £18 million the university puts in to ensure that that's there open to the public. Engagement with the theatre and the development schools, Northwest Cambridge being actually open to people from the city, where we're trying to create a park as pieces, place where people from the city can go and engage with. A collegiate model structure there that actually is not going to have the walls and prevent people coming in and seeing where there is. Working together in this city, I would actually say my experience over 7 years is I've never been in a position that where the city and the county engage with the university more and the university engages with the city and the county more than anywhere else I've been. My experience at Imperial was the last thing anybody in Chelsea or Kensington wanted are students. They bring down the price of property alarmingly quickly. That's never a problem here in Cambridge. We jointly share this problem that we haven't got affordable accommodation for people because we employ so many people. We want to see them housed. We want to see them housed nearby, if at all possible. And we do know that the roads are incredibly congested, but we have to work for new solutions. At one end, the university is exploring all sorts of things. Our resident mole, if I might say, Robert Mayer, is working on ways in which we might look at actually even having in the future a proper underground system that may make communication in this city well, because none of us wants to destroy something that makes Cambridge unique. Any citizen of this city knows we are privileged. In fact, I've often said to others in Europe, you can argue which is the best university in the world, but which is the most attractive university of the world, no question. It is here, because the city is such an attractive place to work. And even if the university takes a self-interest, it is in our interest to maintain the community, because that's why people come to work in this university. Because believe me, we don't pay them anywhere near as much as others do. They come here because of something that the colleges and the city and the county can make very special. So yes, we work together. We actually work together very closely. And relationships here are better than anywhere else that I've experienced. That doesn't mean to say they're always cozy, but we're always prepared to discuss and debate. And that's something to be really proud of and to hang on to for the future.
I very much agree with you that people in the university should communicate better with generally in the world and to people in East Anglia in particular. But if you look at how university departments and university academics are evaluated, there is a strong tendency for people who are extremely productive in internationally recognized research to gain the highest status. And those who are putting a lot of effort into communicating may actually be told that this is going to devalue your worth because you could be spending more time doing the research and you shouldn't be going out and giving lectures in East Anglia or indeed communicating on the internet, or communicating in a general way around the world. So although we have recognition of impact in the REF exercise now, which I think is a very good thing, Can you see a way in which the evaluation of departments and individual academics can be changed in so that the objectives which you put forward can be achieved?
Yeah, this is a very important balance that actually has to occur. First and foremost, if you want to communicate, you've got to have something to communicate. So I don't believe in this idea that those who wish to communicate have got nothing to say or that it's to their detriment, because nobody would be listening if they haven't got something special or a new idea. So for me, the best communicators are very often those who've actually contributed, sometimes through research, but sometimes through their educational other activities, or most importantly, changes of ideas, which we have to begin to put forward. So those are three important elements. There is a particular fundamental difference between Cambridge and every other institution I've had the opportunity to engage with directly, with the possible exception of our friends in the Cotswolds. And that is probably best described by an interview that I was subjected to by Chinese television. It's a very popular program, apparently, in China, but a very sort of aggressive interviewer. She came along and sort of softened you up. First question. So you are in charge of one of the top universities in the world. Tell me, how many papers do you expect an academic to publish? My answer was, over what period? And she said, over a year. And I said, I don't care, none. She then said, so how do you evaluate? What about the H index? My answer was, what is the H index? We have to evaluate by the values that we hold as a university. Therefore, somebody's contribution in a college is valued within that community. And we've got one thing that this university does that so many others do not do. When we appoint somebody here, we are reliant on two things. Firstly, they're not pressurized by having to publish N papers in a given year or to deliver a book. We usually say to them, you can contribute. Frankly, at one point, is go away and do the most important piece of work that you want to do. Because there is a fundamental belief, is giving that academic the freedom to study what they want to is going to yield the best results in whatever field they're actually engaged in. The fruits of that approach are not measured in impact factor, H indices, or whatever. They're actually measured in real advances that change the way the society works. From Trinity College, we had Newton and a whole lot of other people. We also had Byron. People in different fields, but given that opportunity to focus on their future, to focus on making a contribution. And I think if we were to move away from that particular perspective, then I think it would make Cambridge a much weaker place in the longer term. Because we can continue to attract academics, as I was told by one Nobel Prize winning scientist, because we do something here that nobody else seems to do in higher education today. We give an academic the most valuable commodity, and it's not lab space, it's not how many square meters you get, or the plushest office, or the largest salary. It is the thing that we most value, and that's time to focus on the piece of work that we want to do. And if we have a piece of work, whatever it is, then I think the communication must follow, because you've got something to really contribute to the debate that the public have to engage in. So yes, communication is valued, not communication for its own sake, but communication because we have a valuable new idea and something valuable to contribute to that debate in society. So that's why I believe it does matter. I do believe it is valued. It's valued by us. And frankly, if it's not valued by the ref or whatever you want to call it, then to hell with the ref. It actually matters what we think. And that's why I believe this university is unusually a very confident institution in its own values. And you guys have got to defend that well into the future.
Thank you. Thank you.
Vice Chancellor, at the end of your remarks, you quoted the university's motto. So let me quote Homerton's, which is shorter and relevant to this moment, Respice Finem, or look to the end. This is the end of the lecture, but not the end of the evening. Drinks and canapes in the Great Hall, canapes in quantity and quality, should be sufficient for dinner for those who need it to do that job. So student stewards will guide you. Thank you once again.